Morning friends, welcome to today's Sunday worship on the 8th of August, our 11th Sunday after Pentecost. Let us right now go to a time where we come together for the call to worship together. Come, children of God, come and find refuge and strength.
Our souls wait for the Lord. More than those who watch for the morning.
Come, heirs with Christ, come and find forgiveness and joy.
Our souls wait for the Lord, more than those who watch for the morning.
Come, people of faith, come to the one who is attentive to our pleas.
Our souls wait for the Lord, more than those who watch for the morning.
Friend, this morning we want to continue our worship with the opening prayer together.
Lord God, source of faithful love, you redeem us from our wrongs. We come before you today, eager to be refreshed in body and to be made whole in spirit. Feed us from the living bread that comes from heaven. For we are drawn to your Son as steel is drawn to a magnet. Build up our community of faith through the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may live as those who are worthy of our calling. Amen.
For our act of praise, better belongs, worthy of it all, King of Kings.
Nothing saints and angels bow before your throne. All the elders cast their crowns before the Lamb of God and sing, "You are worthy of it all. From you are all things, and to you are all things. You deserve the glory." All the saints and angels bow before your throne.
Praise the Father, praise the
Friends, we want to continue this morning worship with the prayer of confession together.
O God of compassion, if you kept a record of our sins, who could stand? We come before you with our sin and our brokenness for all to see. We bring our anger, our bitterness, our unwholesome talk, and our deceitfulness. We try to do good and fail. We choose to do evil and succeed. Keep your promise to forgive us when we confess to you completely. Without you, we have no hope. Amen. Friends, I'd like to invite you right now to take a moment to pray in silence. Friends, this is the word of assurance given for us. If we confess our sins, God is faithful and will forgive us. God provides freely in the bread of heaven all the mercy we need for life everlasting. The good news is forgiveness in the name of Christ Jesus. Friends, this morning we want to continue our worship with a time of corporate prayer and intercession. First, the bread is my flesh, which I give for the life of the world. John 6:51. Give thanks that we know Jesus, the bread of life. Remember with gratefulness his sacrifice for us on the cross, where his body was broken for us. Pray that we will continue to grow in faith, learning to trust in him and walk closer with him every day. I invite you now to pray. Second, we want to pray for our family. No one can come to me unless the Father who sends me draws them. John 6:44. Pray for family members who do not yet believe in Jesus. Pray that the Father will draw them to him. Pray that the barriers to faith will be overcome. Pray that their eyes will be open to see who Jesus is, believe in him, and receive his love and truth. Friends, I invite you now to pray for your family members. Friends, now we want to remember our nation, Malaysia. Malaysia continues to see around 17,000 new cases of COVID every day. Pray that the number and the severity of infection will decrease. Pray for comfort for the bereaved, healing for the sick, and strength for the frontliners. In the midst of all this, pray for God's will to be done in Parliament, as a motion of confidence will be tabled next month. Friends, I invite you now to pray for our nation, Malaysia. Let us now close as I pray for the nation of Utopia also.
Father in heaven, Lord, we just give thanks for this time, this morning, that we can come before you, Lord, to pray together as a corporate body, as church, for ourselves, for our family, our community, and especially to uphold you, to you, our nation, Malaysia, Lord. Father, we give thanks for all the things that you have done despite the current difficult situation of the pandemic that we face, Lord. And truly, Lord, even as we have prayed for the things that we would like to see, Lord, how things will turn better, Lord, we just want to trust in your sovereignty over all situations, Lord, and we just want to proclaim your almightiness, Lord, in all situations, Lord. Father, at this point, Lord, we just want to pray for the nation of Utopia, Lord. We want to ask, Lord, that you will grant to this nation peace, Lord, even as there are fighting between the Tigrayan forces and the government, Lord. We pray for the people that has been displaced because of this fighting, Lord. And we ask, Lord, that you be merciful, Lord, to the people that are affected by the famine and those that need food, Lord, and especially the children who are at risk for life-threatening malnutrition for the next coming 12 months, Lord. Truly, Lord, we just pray that you, as you are a God of peace, you will grant this nation, Lord, and be merciful to this nation, that you will grant them peace, and that indeed, Lord, the help that they need, the aid that is required, Lord, and the supplies will reach those that are in need, Lord. Father, sometimes in our place, Lord, we do not know why you allow such violence happen, Lord, but even as we pray, we just want to trust that you are sovereign and you are in control of all situation, Lord. So, Lord, for this morning of all the prayer that we have uttered, Lord, we just want to commit it into your hand and pray that even as we trust in you, Lord, you yourself, Lord, will answer our prayer according to your own will and your timing. All this, Lord, we just want to commit and pray in Christ Jesus' most precious name. Amen.
Today's reading is taken from John chapter 6, verses 35 to 51. Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger. Whoever believes in me shall never thirst. But I said to you that you have seen me and yet do not believe. All that the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me I will never cast out. For I have come down from heaven, not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I should lose nothing of all that he has given me, but raise it up on the last day. For this is the will of my Father, that everyone looks on the Son and believes in him shall have eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. So the Jews grumbled about him, because he said, I am the bread that came down from heaven. They said, Is not this Jesus the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How does he now say, I have come down from heaven? Jesus answered them, Do not grumble among yourselves. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up on the last day. It is written in the prophets, and they will all be taught by God. Everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. Not that anyone has seen the Father, except he who is from God. He has seen the Father. Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life. Your fathers ate the manna in the wilderness and they died. This is the bread that comes down from heaven, so that one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh. This is the word of God.
Let us pray. Lord God, our Father, we thank you once again for your word that has been read to us. We pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. On 4th August, Nathaniel Tan, who lives in the Klang Valley, began a hunger strike. It was to bring attention to the state of things in the country. Like many, he is frustrated over the situation in the country and decided that he would do something about it. And you may have read about him in the social media or even the newspapers. He's making five demands. And these demands are really about truth-telling, about doing what is just and caring for the frontliners. And this hunger strike, fasting, which is fasting from food only, reveals a deeper yearning, a hunger for truth to be made known, for justice and for care for fellow citizens, when those who should speak the truth, who should be carrying out justice, and who should be caring for the people are doing the very opposite. This pandemic has not only revealed physical hunger in people, it has also uncovered needs which cannot be satisfied by things which are material. These are hungers that go beyond the material and the physical. Last week, if you remember, we reflected on verses 24 to 35 of John chapter 6. We saw how Jesus satisfies our soul hunger for love through reconciling us with God the Father. This kind of hunger is also really a hunger of the heart. And when the Bible speaks of the heart, it means much more than just that organ that pumps blood through our bodies. The heart, the very center of our being, the place from which we make decisions, where we think, where our desires reside, from which comes our actions and our words. It is the inner person, the source of our emotions. It is this place that the Bible calls the heart. You and I are made with hearts for God. That's how God created us. The desire for God, our choices, our words, our actions, reflecting and honoring God. That is how we were created. But when sin entered into human life, human beings lost God in the heart. And from that time, every human being, every heart yearns for and hungers for God. Do you and I see that in ourselves? Do we see, do we recognize that particular hunger? And if we do, how can that hunger be met? Well, Jesus, the bread of life, not only fills us and meets that hunger, but also shows us how to keep being filled. It is with doing the will of God. And that was how Jesus himself was nourished. My food is to do the will of him who sent me. That's what Jesus told the disciples, if you remember. They had gone into town to get food when they were in Samaria, and Jesus was sitting beside the well. A Samaritan woman came, Jesus engaged her in conversation, and out of that, God did a work in that woman's heart, and she was led to believe in Jesus. And how Jesus felt full of gratitude, full of joy, full of whatever it is when you know that you have done God's will to the full. My food is to do the will of Him who sent me. Often people say, we want to do God's will, but what is God's will for me? I don't know how to know God's will. Usually when people say that, they mean, what is God's will for me in my life situation here and now specifically? So perhaps there is an expectation that God will lay out the plans, as it were, for us. But what is wanted here, what is expressed in that statement, is really a desire for a blueprint or a prescription. God, tell me what you want me to do and I'll follow it. Follow it exactly and you get the desired results. That's the thinking behind that. But God's will is not like that. And God does not desire for our relationship with Him to be stunted in that way, because if God were to tell us exactly what to do, what His will is, that's how our relationship with Him will be stunted. Because such kinds of things are mostly used with either robots or with little children who must be told exactly what to do so that they will learn what is right and what the right way is to do things. God's desire is to relate with His people as adult children. Children who are growing on to maturity, who are able to catch His heart, and who are partners with Him in His work. Well, if you want to know God's will, it's simple. It's contained in the two greatest commandments. Love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. Everything else that God wills for us is based on these two commandments. Jesus lived these two commandments perfectly. It is to Him we must look if we want to learn how to carry out God's will. The first thing we need to know is that Jesus loved God with His whole being, so much so that the times alone with God were of utmost importance to Him. No compromising on that. And He would even forsake sleep to be with His Father if He had had such a busy day. He would pray through the night. We read that in different places in the Gospels. Or He would get up. The sun gets up even before the sun rises to be with the Father. In that time of communion with Father, Jesus sees what the Father is doing. And so when He moves out to minister, He does the same. In that time of communion with Father, Jesus comes to know the Father's heart. And so He knows what the Father desires and wants. In today's text, we find that God's will, the Father's will, is that all who are drawn to Jesus will not be lost, but instead will be nurtured, and when time comes to an end, will be resurrected. It is God at work, teaching people, drawing them to Jesus so that they may be saved. And it is those who hear. And we have looked at that, what that means sometime before this. It is those who hear who will draw near to Jesus. You and I, if we want to know God's will, we are called first to listen to what God has to teach us. And we do this, first of all, through engaging with Scripture. It is very, very rare that God actually speaks with an audible voice, because He has given us Himself, His communication through Scripture. So that is the first place we go to learn God's will. So we read Scripture not to analyze it or master it or understand it, but to stand under it. In other words, we allow Scripture to speak to us, and we listen and receive what God has to teach us, allowing the Word, we take the Word into our minds as we read, and we allow that Word to percolate from our mind down into our hearts. And this is essential, because this will feed not just our mind, but also our hearts, that place from which we make choices, from which our speech and our actions spring. It is in spending time with the Father that we are drawn close to Him. It is in spending time with the Father that we come to know His heart like Jesus did. And then we shall come to know His will and what to do in our situation, in the circumstances we find ourselves. So coming to know God's will is always, always within our relationship with God. It cannot take place outside of that relationship. So that's why those who do not have a relationship with God will not know God's will. We also have the privilege, when we know God's will, to be witnesses of God's work in the lives of people as we share with them. Lives transformed, lives that blossom, lives which thrive, and hearts drawn to Jesus and fed by the bread of life, just as we have been in drawing near to God. And believe me, being a witness to how God is working in people's life is an immense privilege and grace. Jesus is the one who has come from the Father to show us what a life of joyful obedience to God's will looks like. Jesus has come from the Father as the true bread, the bread that feeds our hearts and our souls, bringing us eternal life. And eternal life in truth is this: coming to know God and Jesus in a personal way. Jesus says as much himself in John 17, verse 3. Jesus is the bread of life who feeds our deepest hungers with the promise that we shall not hunger and thirst if we go to him. With all that God has done and Jesus has done, you and I are invited, called to respond to the hand that is extended to us. We still have to respond to the call to come to me. So the question is, how will we respond? The Jews' response to Jesus was to grumble. And that word, grumble, is the same word used of their ancestors in the desert when they grumbled about Moses, when they grumbled even about God. And while the Israelites recognized that manna had come from God, it did not stop them from grumbling that they had no meat. And when they grumbled that there was no water, God provided water. But that didn't stop them from grumbling again when they thought that there was no more water. There was always something that was not right for them. Have you ever met people like that? Or are we like that ourselves? Always one thing or another is not right to us. Note that John tells us the Jews' response was to grumble. They were not puzzled. They were not confused by what Jesus said. They were not asking Jesus what he meant. They just grumbled. And what was it that they grumbled about? It was that Jesus had said that he came down from heaven and that it is by believing in him that they will have eternal life. And so they grumbled because they knew him, or so they thought. Jesus was someone they had seen growing up, their next door neighbor even. They knew his parents and his family. He was one of them. And in that culture, knowing someone's family was important because that formed bonds. So he was kind of like homeboy to them. So how can he be saying now that he came from heaven? How can he say that they must put their faith in him rather than God? How can he be saying that he is the bread of life, that it is his flesh? So scandalous. And Jesus was in effect equating himself with God. Remember that these are the very people who were longing for God. They were longing for God to send the Anointed One, the Messiah, because for them, the Messiah would be the one leading them out of the overlordship of the Romans, those pagans who had invaded their God-given land. But Jesus, our homeboy, cannot be. And so they rejected Jesus. What was happening was that the Jews only looked at the horizontal. Their minds were closed. They did not even ask good questions, which would help open their eyes to the truth. Honest questions, which perhaps would lead them to see what God was actually up to. And even though they had read or heard the scriptures read, which told them of the Messiah, they did not learn. They did not allow God to teach them. God's desire is this, that all people be saved. And that is why Jesus came, to seek out and save the lost, all of humanity. And God does what he will to draw us to Jesus. And we are called to respond. How will we respond? How do we view Jesus? Many call him a good teacher. Is that how we see him? Only. Many see him as a kind and compassionate man who helped those in need. Others see him as a rebel, going against establishment, saying the most scandalous things, and they are drawn to him. Or do we see Jesus as the one whom God sent from heaven to bring us back into relationship with God, the one who died for our sins, so that the relationship between us and God may be restored. What we believe about Jesus determines our response and what happens after we say yes or no to Jesus. If we do not see Jesus as the Son of God sent from heaven to save us, then we will only see him as the Jews did, or we will only see him as a good teacher saying good things, even though hard sometimes, or we will see him as a miracle worker alone, or we will see him as a compassionate person or a rebel. And eventually, like the Jews, we will reject him. We will choose only to take those teachings and works which pleases us, do not threaten us, and we will never get to experience Jesus' saving work in our lives. And so if you have been looking at Jesus only in that little window, or only from one particular aspect, I want to invite you to consider Jesus in the fullness of his life and who he is. For those of us who have responded to that initial call and have come to Jesus, there is still that ongoing call for us to grow into the likeness of Jesus. There is still that call to work with God on his mission. And just as God entrusted Jesus with seeking out the lost and making disciples, so God also entrusts us, the body of Christ, with that same mission. How will we respond to that? Are we simply content to having answered that initial call to come to Jesus? Are we content to be in the fold, going about our life day in and day out without much attention to Jesus and his presence in our lives? Are we content to live as everybody else does? In 2005, in the year 2005, Ronald J. Sider, theologian and social activist, published a book with the title The Scandal of the Evangelical Conscience: Why Are Christians Living Just Like the Rest of the World? In that book, he looks at how evangelicals in America were living. Evangelicals are those who are defined as Bible-believing, born-again Christians, those who have said yes to Jesus. He drew on polls which had been conducted by various organizations, and these polls found this, that, and the, I quote, they divorce their spouses as often as their secular neighbors. They beat their wives as often as their neighbors. They were almost as materialistic and even more racist than their pagan friends. Gallup and Barna, organizations that conducted surveys, hand us survey after survey demonstrating that evangelical Christians are as likely to embrace lifestyle every bit as hedonistic, materialistic, self-centered, and sexually immoral as the world in general. The thing is this, in every age, the church is in danger of being sucked into following the ways of the world, of viewing Jesus through the lens of the world like the Jews, instead of seeing him as he is presented to us in the gospel, as God has revealed him to us. And the Apostle Paul knew what this meant because he himself was in that position, persecuting those who followed Jesus, because to him, Jesus was just simply another Jewish teacher. And so after he had changed, after he had been converted and realized how wrong he was, this is what he wrote. From now on, therefore, we regard no one according to the flesh, even though we once regarded Christ according to the flesh, we regard him thus no longer. If you and I are not actively discerning the presence of Jesus Christ, whether it be discerning him personally or together as a community, if we are not keeping our eyes on Jesus and what he is doing in our midst and calling us to, we are in trouble. And we end up majoring in the minors. And I can't help, as I write this, as I work through this sermon, I can't help but recall one LCEC meeting I was in where 45 minutes was spent just debating over the use of the word contingency in one of the reports. I was much younger then, but it made such an impression on me, and I shudder to think back on that now, that amount of time wasted. I pray that our churches don't fall into this place, that if we do, God will open our eyes so that we may once again set our eyes on Jesus and follow him as he is, the Son of God, Savior of the world, and Lord of all. If we do not, if we will not, we end up in a church without life. We end up being a church without life. Oh yes, we may have activities and we may do a lot of things, but we will not have the life of Christ which he came to give us, which is the very purpose for the existence of the church, to have that life and to share it with people. And if we are Christians, then we must follow Christ wholly, wholly, and we must follow Christ totally. Let me share with you the story of Dorothy Day. Dorothy Day was one who had a great heart hunger. Her hunger was for justice and to help the poor. Under that hunger was a hunger to be loved and to love. Over the course of her young adult life, she joined socialist groups with communist leanings, participating in rallies and marching for causes, because this was what she was hungry for, because these people were trying to help the poor, were working for a better society. At the same time, there was something that drew her to the Christian faith. She was not a Christian. And through that time, among the books she was reading were The Imitation of Christ, Pascal Penzias, a devotional, writers like Dostoevsky and Tolstoy, who wrote with faith, and their novels were all suffused with the Christian faith. Her hunger led her to slip into early morning masses at St. Joseph's Church, even though she was not a Christian at that time. That hunger for love led to failed marriages, the last one being a common law, so-called a common law marriage with Foster Batterham. He was a committed atheist and hostile toward what she called all man-made institutions, and that for him included marriage. She had a child by him, and by then she had found that her hunger was being nourished by faith, faith in Christ. And she knew then that she would want her baby to be baptized. At the same time, she realized that it would mean losing Foster Batterham. She finally made the choice and she joined the Catholic Church and was baptized. Her daughter, Tama Teresa, was also baptized. Batterham left them. She moved back to New York, and it was the time of the Great Depression. Her heart was deeply moved by the plight of those who were out of work, and she prayed to God in anguish for some way to open for her to use what talents she had for her fellow worker, for the poor. This time God answered almost instantaneously, because when she returned to her apartment, she found someone waiting for her. His name, Peter Morin. He had been told to see her because his acquaintances had told him that he and Dorothy thought very much alike. And that was the start of a collaboration and work for the rest of their lives. And this would result in the publication first of the Catholic Worker, a magazine or a paper which publicized Catholic social teaching. It also led to hospitality houses for their works of mercy to care for the homeless and the poor. In time, they came to have regular retreats for their workers, which would sustain them in the work and give them strength as they worked in desperate circumstances, because more and more people were attracted to join them. For Dorothy, these retreats were precious times in which she found wonder and she found strength. Not long before her death, Dorothy Day spoke to Dr. Robert Coles, who had got to know her and worked with her in the soup kitchens as a young medical student. And this is what she said to him: "It will soon be over. I try to think back. I try to remember this life that the Lord gave me the other day. I wrote down the words, a life remembered. And I was going to make a summary for myself, write what mattered most. But I couldn't do it. I just sat there and thought of our Lord and his visit to us all those centuries ago. And I said to myself that my great luck was to have had him on my mind for so long in my life." Dorothy Day's great hunger of the heart for love, for justice, for the poor, found the food and nourishment it needed in our Lord Jesus, the bread of life. Jesus came to do God's will. Jesus came to show us what God's will is. And if we want to be obedient to God's will, we must come to Jesus first of all. God's hand extends to draw us to Jesus, and our response is to accept Jesus, the bread of life, come down to us from heaven, not as we want him to be, but as he is. Only then will we find our heart hungers and desires satisfied and our thirst quenched. Let us pray. Lord God, our Father, thank you for our Lord Jesus Christ, the bread of life, whom you sent to satisfy the hunger that sin created in us, the hunger for you, the hunger to be loved, the hunger for justice, the hunger for so many things that only you can satisfy. We thank you for all that you have done. And for those of us who want to follow Jesus in our lives, who want Jesus in a deeper way, and who still have hunger in our heart and want it satisfied, now is the time to tell Jesus, yes, please, would you come into my heart as you are, not as I want, but as you are. And I would invite you to tell him and open your hearts to him now. God, our Father, you have heard those prayers which have been said. Jesus, would you enter to those hearts and fill them and satisfy them as only you know how to. Thank you for being the bread of life to us, for it is in your precious and holy name we pray. Amen. Let me invite us now to soul training this week. Last week, if you remember, you were invited to allow the Holy Spirit to show you the hunger in your soul. This week, take time to review. If you have done that, take time to review how that hunger was satisfied through the week. Continue to ask the Holy Spirit to show you what other hunger there is in your heart, and talk to Jesus and allow him to satisfy it as well. The second exercise is to read John 6, 35 to 51 contemplatively. So read it once through slowly, savor the words, and then read it a second time, also slowly, and notice any word or phrase that stands out for you, or perhaps an image may come to your mind. Hold on to that word or that phrase or that image. Then read the text a third time slowly, looking to see the invitation that God has for you in that word or phrase or image. Take time to talk with God about what has come up for you, what emerges for you in this exercise, and may you be blessed in practicing it. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Brothers and sisters, let us say the key verse together. John chapter 6, verse 35. Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger, and whoever believes in me shall never thirst. Our hymn of response, softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling.
Calling for you.
Brothers and sisters, welcome to the Seremban Wesley Worship Service this morning. We want to welcome all of you who are joining us from wherever you may be. And we pray that you have been blessed and have encountered the Lord in our worship service today. Allow me to share with you some concerns of the church this morning. First, Crest Quarantine Center in KL. We are thankful to the Lord that Crest, a disaster relief organization, has received permission, approval to run a quarantine center for Category 1 and 2 COVID patients from the B40 groups and migrants. And so those who want to donate to this cause, do read the details in the e-bulletin. And when you send in your donations, please remember to mark it specifically as for Crest PKRCS. Yeah, for Crest PKRCS. You may bank in online or call the church office, the church handphone office, to see if there is anyone in the office, because we are not opening the office, but our staff do go by the office once in a way. Secondly, reading scripture together. There will be a series of sessions on reading scripture to see what it is that the Bible says. And the first session for this will begin on 1st September. This will take place every first and third Wednesdays of the month. And we will begin with Genesis chapters 1 to 3, taking one chapter per session to look at origins, how things came to be the way they are. And so do let the church office know if you would like to join so that we can send you the Zoom link when the time comes near. You need to let the church office know so that the link can be sent to you. Tuesday, in 2 days' time, it will be a day of fasting and prayer. It will be the whole day, but there will be a coming together of churches and Christians from the nation from 9 a.m. to 12 noon to pray together. And so the link is in the bulletin. And when you click on that link, you will be taken to a page that will allow you to click on the language that you most naturally pray in. And so do come join this. And from now until Tuesday, do keep the team and our Bishop Jayakuma and the rest of the people who are working to put this together, do keep them in prayer, especially those who are hosting this online. And do pray that the internet connections will be steady and that this event can take place. And so let me invite us to our hymn of commitment, Behold the Lamb. And this is a communion hymn, although we had communion last week, but we want to sing this as a commitment to follow our Lord Jesus Christ. Behold the Lamb.
Sins away, slain for us.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, receive the benediction. Having been filled by the bread of life, Jesus Christ, go forth into this world where hunger and thirst persist. Bring the healing, life-sustaining, nourishing word of God and the peace and love of Jesus Christ. Offer the transforming witness of the Holy Spirit to all you meet. And the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with us and all our loved ones, now and always. Amen.